Hey, what's up guys? I hope everybody's doing fine, and today we're going to have a look at one of my sneak peek videos on the repertoire that I'm preparing for Chessable. As you can see it clearly from the logo, it's a Chessable thing. It's a Chessable file, and it's all about the English opening, namely after c4, but you can also get some other move orders. You can also get it with knight f3, or you can get it with even moves like g3 on the first move, or a3 for example, or b3. So that would be the repertoire which is going to serve you whenever your opponent is going for this reversed Sicilian setup. So this game is one of the model games that I'm using there, and it's a little bit strange the way that Korchnoi reached the position. He reached it via this Grünfeld move order. So he was offering Grünfeld to his opponent. Now anytime that white wants to play d4, he can play it and they'll be back in the Grünfeld, but Hübner didn't want to go for that, and he chose instead of that g3, bishop e7, and after e5 we are reaching what I actually want you to reach. We are reaching this setup, the reversed Fianchetto system in the English opening. So the idea is that we are slowly equalizing, and this is something that we should do as black, and that's the classical way of doing it. And only after that, little by little, we're going to gain some time, and we're going to gain some space, we're going to gain some squares, whatever is needed to gain some advantage, and eventually win this battle, win the opponent. What exactly is this system? How exactly does it look like? Well, in the normal Sicilians, in the normal line of the Sicilians, say the normal dragon or the normal accelerated dragon, after the trade in g6, knight c3, bishop g7, this knight has difficulty staying in the middle, so white is going to drop it back, and after knight f6, or the preliminary d6, g3, and then d6, bishop g2, this is exactly the system that we are looking at the moment. True. In the system that we have after the move e5, the way that Korchnoi played, well, white is up a tempo, but can he really make use of that? If he doesn't have the trick knight xe5 working here, most likely he cannot. And here it doesn't work, of course, if there is knight c3, give me the queen, give me the knight, we're going to win a piece. So for that reason, white should castle, and then after knight e7, he has various ways of trying to play for the advantage. Actually, Korchnoi played it in a very tricky way. This knight is not yet on c6, and the major problem for the second player here is the advance of that pawn. But I don't see how can he profit from that in this particular situation. And for that reason, Hübner played slowly with d3, then after knight bc6, bishop g2, again he played a little bit slowly. And of course, this is not the only move that they have. They could have played other moves like queen c1, or they could have played other setups, but this is something that you will see in the repertoire if you decide to take it. It's up to you. Korchnoi jumped with the knight on d4, which is one of the good plans that black has in this situation, and that's not the only plan. Of course, he could have gone for h6, followed by, in case of knight e4, with the move b6, slowly taking the squares away from this knight, and also preparing the move f5, as we're stronger on the king side and we want to play on the king side, and this is the reason why we want to get there. Next, we want to play bishop b7 as well, etc. So knight e4, what's the idea of knight e4? It's a very typical Sicilian idea. Whenever they capture it, then you recapture back with the pawn, the e-file would be opened, there'll be a backward pawn on e2, and that's the pawn that we would like to attack afterwards. If they don't take it, they will have to play a move like e3, and then we're going to take on f3 ourselves, a little bit relieving the defense. Also, we don't have to care about that pawn anymore, as our next move is going to be c6, so this attack on the c-file will not be that effective. Hübner took it immediately, and then he tried to show some activity with the move knight e4, which was his original plan. Apparently he wants to attack that pawn on b7, and then h6 led to a position which is very close to equality, but both sides have to be careful. Why do they have to be careful? Well, it's pretty obvious why black has to be careful. He has problems with his queen side and he didn't yet develop it, but white also has to be careful. It's not that obvious that he has to be careful, but sometimes this knight doesn't really have way back. have a look at it. Right now it is centralized, but most of the squares have been taken either by his pieces or by the opponent's pieces. This one is available, but after we go Rb8 and b6, it will become unavailable, and this is something that we want to do anyway. We want to expand on the queen side. And there is a danger that this knight is getting trapped, and sometimes we can first attack it and then go for this. So white has to be careful, but Hübner wasn't, and he played the move queen to b3, which actually is a very unfortunate, very poor square for the queen. And Korsunoy is immediately punishing him with the move that he wanted to play anyway. So he's protecting the c5 square, and he is going to go for f5 after bishop e6 first, and then f5. So this is a moment where we see that this plan with f5 is working really very fast, and the queen is actually badly misplaced there. Another line where we see that the queen is misplaced is this line where white is taking the exchange on e8, but after bishop e6, once again the queen is suffering, and because of the queen, actually the bishop is going to suffer at the end of the day. Another idea for white in this situation, tactical idea, is to capture on h6 and then do knight f6 check, but this doesn't really change anything. Not only that, we have still bishop e6 if we want, but we can even capture first on c1 and maybe even capture the knight on f6. It's up to you which one would you like to take, this one or the one on e8. It's all good. And for that reason, Hübner couldn't find anything better but to play the move queen to c4, but the queen is still on this diagonal, so Korsunoy is defending this rook on the long diagonal, and he wants to play bishop e6 and f5, as I told you. So this is his trap, this is his main idea. On bishop b4, he defended everything with the move bishop to d7, and also he avoided a trap himself. C5, which looks like a great move in tendings to this, oops, sorry, with tempos, would be met with knight takes c5. This time this works for white, as he's attacking way too many things. He's moving the queen away with the tempo, and at the same time he's attacking a lot of things, so he's going to regain the material with interest. That's not going to be nice. Finally, a move like bishop e6 was possible, actually, and black would be doing fine after these captures, so this would be approximately equal, but apparently Korsunoy wants more than the equality, so he's slowly bringing his pieces out. Next he wants to play c5, then bishop e6, then f5, and finally this knight is going to suffer, or he will just force the opponent's pieces backwards to go all the way back home. Queen e6 is trying to prevent a5 ideas, but this is not going to, the queen is not going to stay there for very long. Korsunoy just pushing the bishop back, then the queen back, and finally plays the move a5. So this bishop now is buried. And again, the knight f6 idea is not working because the queen is still very sensitive, this time on another light square, the square a4. So on a5, he had to keep on moving backwards, and then we have knight e5, very typical maneuver, and another very typical maneuver after that, rook e8, followed by rook, actually I'm going to show it to you in a second. So this is the ideal setup that we are looking for. This pawn on d4 moved from e5, and we have the half-open e-file for our pieces. We're going to put as much pressure as we can there. On the queen side, we have pawn majority, meaning that we are stronger there too. This bishop is out of the game. If white wants to bring it in, he will have to play b3 and bishop b2 or bishop c1, but this is going to weaken the c3 and the b4 squares even further. Next, we also want to chase away this knight. So we are better on either side of the board. We can attack, standard attack here is against the pawn on e2. We can double, triple our major pieces and eventually try to take it. And we can also combine this with the advance of the pawns. But we can also easily switch to the play on the queen side. So from, we can say that from a strategical point of view, our position is close to winning, actually, and this is not exaggeration. If white goes e3 anytime in the future, whenever we take it, he will have two weak hanging pawns, which we can attack. We are going to have the solid pawn structure, and it's also easy for us. We already have our pieces attacking them. All in all, this speaks about the quality of black's position, and Korsunoy proved that actually quite fast. This maneuver is the one that I wanted to mention, rook e7, followed by rook e7, The rook moved away from the pen, from that bishop's activity, and actually now the bishop becomes an empty piece. If you haven't heard this term, it's a good moment for you to learn it. Empty means that it looks active, it controls a lot of squares, but at the same time, it doesn't really influence the game, it doesn't really do anything. So next, after queen d1, everything goes very smoothly and very obviously for black. He goes f5, bishop e7 was an alternative, it wasn't bad, and then he did b5 to deprive his opponent of that square as well, but also to back up this knight, which wants to jump on c3, and after the trade, this pawn is ready to back it up, and we're going to turn one advantage into another. Instead of a powerful central knight, we're going to take the bishop pair, and we're going to get a very dangerous outside pass pawn. And the immediate knight c3 was also good. By the way, and after bishop c3, d takes c3, knight c4, b5 is still an option, but apparently Korsunoy didn't want to allow this knight to go to c2, from where it can block the queenside majority of his opponent. And therefore, he played b5, which is even more precise. So c4 square has been taken away from this knight, and the knight has less and less air. So, sorry, this is not going to happen. He took on d5, queen takes d5, and he did f3. Whenever you see your opponent taking on d5 with his fianchettoed bishop, that means that probably he is about to resign. Strictly speaking, this is one of those cases where if you give away such a powerful piece and a piece which is defending your king, you're either doing this in front of a gun or you don't do it at all. So a4 now, I told you we are better on either flank. We can attack on the king side, we can attack on the queen side. Right now on the king side, he managed to stabilize his position a bit. So it's time for us to attack on the other side. Rook f2, rook e7, and after queen c2, bishop e6, the pressure becomes unbearable here. Anytime white captures on e4, then the rook is going to recapture and this pawn is going to go west. It doesn't really matter if he pushes it or not. Or the other thing that we can do, we can start pushing the c pawn after some preparation. Let's defend this guy next. We're going to play c4 and these pawns are going to be unstoppable. So this is the reason why Hübner defended with rook b1. But then don't forget about the king side. Let's play there a bit. And here, an interesting decision by Korsunoy. If I were him, I would have taken on e3. After all, this is why he started doubling the rooks on the a-file, just to occupy it and eventually to penetrate on that file. And also, when the bishop's alive with two bishops and with files in our favor, just controlling them, I feel like we should be having more files for our pieces and diagonals for our pieces. But he decided to completely smother the bishop with the move e3. And this is also a great plan. Look at now at the white pieces. They're all lacking space. They don't have a chance to go anywhere. Then knight f1, c4 was played. Still, he didn't give up pushing that pawn. Actually, he wants to clear this one and to take the one on a2. So the one on a3 is not only smothering the bishop, but it's also sort of a reserved passer, ready to go and get promoted. White took. He tried knight e2 to defend, but he had to abandon that pawn on a2. And black had won a pawn, obviously, here. He still kept his advantages, he still has the bishop pair, he still has the mark to pieces. So he's completely winning. The next moves I'm going to show you really very quickly. So up to one moment, I would say Hübner did the best that he could do. But after some centralization of his pieces, and after some preparation, Korsunoy managed to grind him down. So you can see how easily he's improving everything that he has. That pawn too, it's important. It takes away the air of the opponent's pieces. Now the threat is to capture on e4, and then to come and take that pawn. And also he's going to have a lot of passers. So this knight has to leave the active position. Make sure that you don't take on g2 and on f3, because two extra pawns in situations like that do not necessarily lead to a win for you, as the pawns are too close to each other and we have opposite colored bishops. But bringing the king to the queen side is the right thing to do. And you remember I have mentioned that pawn, it was important to push it all the way to h3. Here you can see why. It's also a reserved passer, but it's also fixing a pawn on h2, a weakness on h2 that we are attacking at the moment. And because of that, white had to abandon the second pawn without actually gaining any counterplay. And okay, the rest is relatively easy, even though Korchnoi had to be careful not to give away that pawn for this bishop, as then we have the wrong corner here, but he managed to not give that pawn at all, as he's threatening simply to go bishop g2, followed by bishop somewhere, followed by this little dance with the bishop when the pawn is going to get promoted. Say bishop b3, actually bishop b3 will be bishop c5, not bishop b3. So say some other move like bishop g5, give me the bishop. He needs to stab the pawn from this side. Honestly speaking, this is the fastest win, but okay, so let's say that this king wasn't even on a dark square. So let's say that he goes king f1, king f3, whatever. Bishop d2, bishop c7, now bishop to g5, bishop a5, and that's the dance when the bishop comes on c3 and nobody can stop the pawn from being promoted. So that's a model game that you will find in the Chessable repertoire, and this is the beating the English the slow way, if I can put it this way. It's not exactly the title, but in a slow motion, that explains what it's all about. Thanks for watching this, and I hope you will enjoy the repertoire as well. See you soon.